ఇదే నాడు ఇదే భాష ఎందెందు నన్నదాగిరలి ఎల్లే ఇరలి హేగరిరలి కన్నడవే నమ్మ ఉసిరల్లి ఇదే నాడు ఇదే భాష ఎందెందు నన్నదాగిరలి
హలో ఫ్రెండ్స్ వెల్కమ్ టు యువర్ ఓన్ ఛానల్ కన్నడ ఎక్స్ప్లాయిట్స్ So in today's video, we're going to look into a walkthrough of Metasploitable 2. In the previous video, we have already seen about how do you hack a Metasploitable 2 through a VSFTPD service, a vulnerable VSFTPD service, which was actually a FTP service which was running on port 21. So we already seen the port 21 enumeration and exploitation techniques. So in today's video, we're going to look up into the other ports and try to see enumeration in various other services. And finally, our intention would be to compromise and gain access on our victim computer. Right? So let us start our discussion. So before that, if you have not yet subscribed to our channel, so kindly subscribe our channel so that and click on the bell icon so that you will receive the latest updates whenever we try to upload any new videos. Another thing is whatever we are trying to do now, it's an intermediate a knowledge of or a skill level in terms of hacking. So in case if you're not much new to the port scanning techniques, all those basic stuff, so I would recommend you to go through the basic analogy from basic sessions on our basic videos in our channel. You can have a look into that, or you could also look up into the VSFTPD service based exploitation in the playlist CTF walkthrough and basic hacking walkthroughs, and then come to this session, this video, so that you'll have a pretty much kind of a stable knowledge and experience level, right? So without wasting much time, let us dive into today's session, right? So we already know this is our template as usually. So hence we want to be following the similar phase, that is information gathering, exploitation, privilege escalation, and so on, right? So hence our first intention would be to gain information about our target. So let us start the exploitation by identifying what was the service and what all ports are open in the victim machine and so on. So let us start with the identifying the IP addresses, right? So I'm not yet confirmed about what is my network. So let me do the simple ping scan to identify which is my victim's IP address. So in this case, I have seen around like 5 computers are online. So if you see, the 5 computers, the first one is a router, okay, and let me come to the second one later, but second, if you see, it is a Intel corporate adapter, probably it's my other computer, and this is 103, which is my mobile phone, which has an adapter of Arcadian, it's another mobile phone, and 104 is my own IP address, okay, you can just do ifconfig, so I would recommend to do ifconfig first and come to this later, so that you can have a clear understanding. And if you can see, 104 is my own IP address. So the leftover is obviously 101. You can also verify that with the adapter called Oracle VirtualBox, because I'm running my victim computer from Oracle VirtualBox, right? So the IP address here is basically 192.168.0.101. Okay, let us paste that over here. So we've got the IP address. So let's go forward to see what ports are open and what ports are closed. As simple as that, right? So we have already done port scanning in the last session itself. So let me just give you a guide through in the last from the Metasploitable response we have got. So if you observe, it's almost the same thing what we have seen in the last session, the last video, that where we exploited with VSFTPD. So since we've already done with port 21, we've already exploited it. So let us go forward to the next port, and the next port is port 22. So port 22 and the service that is running on port 22 is SSH, which stands for Secured Shell. Now this protocol or this service is used to have a remote control over a remote administration on a computer. So typically SSH service is used whenever you want to access another computer from your computer, but the underlying protocol depends upon the credentials, which means in order to access the remote machine, you need to have a valid credentials. Okay, so only if you have a credential, only then you'll be able to access the service. Now you may ask me that whether it's not, is it not possible to hack SSH service? Obviously, port SSH, I mean the service SSH can be hacked. So there are typically two ways of hacking into SSH service. One is you have some vulnerability in the service that is running SSH, I mean the application that is running SSH service. Second is you have to crack the username password of SSH. So you cannot directly go and try some wildcards over a machine, isn't it? So you should at least know what is the valid usernames. Only then we can go forward, right? So the password cracking is off the mark currently. So the only way that is left out to us to hack SSH or to hack a machine through SSH service is to find out if this service has any vulnerability. So let us go forward and go to the, Google to see if there's any exploit for this particular attack, for this particular service. And Google gives us a negative information for remote code execution thing. So the only way which is shown here is a couple of information gatherings. But apart from that, this service does not have any other major vulnerabilities. So this version of SSH, which is currently with Metasploit Double 2, does not have any major vulnerability or any kind of a code execution or a command execution vulnerability unless until you are authenticated. So even the Metasploit which is shown here will ask you for credentials, where we do not have such credentials to do that, right? Second thing is you can either crack the passwords with a word list, but even for that you will be requiring the valid usernames. And it's also out of context. So there's already an example in our channel. If you go to the password cracking playlist, there we have already added a small video for password cracking scenarios. So there you can have a lookout in how to crack Wi-Fi, how to crack system passwords, and how to crack SSH passwords. So there you can use, you can see how do you crack SSH passwords using Hydra. Okay, hence in a current session, you will not be looking up into SSH password cracking. So let's go forward to the next protocol, that is next port number, that is port 23, in which we are running Telnet. Now what is Telnet? Telnet is a brother of SSH. You could also call it an elder brother of SSH. Because even in Telnet, the reason why we use Telnet is to control or access the remote computer from our computer using authentication. So the only difference between Telnet and SSH is that SSH works on encrypted protocol, whereas Telnet works on plain text protocol. That's the only difference between Telnet and SSH, except that they work similar. They work similarly. So, but the only thing is Telnet is plain text and SSH is encrypted text. Next comes, leads us to a SMTP service. Now what is SMTP service? SMTP stands for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, and it is used by your mail servers. Remember, when you log into any email service provider, it could be email, Gmail, Outlook, Yahoo, whatever it is. So these servers that's actually having your mail, that actually contains your mail, is nothing but your mail exchange server or mail server. Now the actual job of your mail servers is to receive mail from any user who is sending you mail. They receive mail, or it is used to send the mail, right? So the server's job is to receive a mail and send the mail. But how are the users? So what happens in SMTP service, or what happens in your mail exchange service, is that they define the username based on the email ID itself. So if you see any typical email ID, let's say, let me take my own email ID. It is nbhartqmara@gmail.com, right? So what happens, what is the information that is disclosed here is that the format is always username of the service at the server. Okay, so in this case, nbharatkumara would become the username. Okay, Kumara would be the username. Sorry for the typo. Right, to the server, and a server would be gmail.com. Which means, what does it mean in other words, is that in the server, in the computer called gmail.com, there is a valid user by name nbharatkumara. Right, there's a valid user. So in this case, I can identify this way. What are the email IDs that I found? If you take any website or any service provider, what all usernames that you will be finding up in the email ID, that username would be a valid user in that particular computer. Okay, in other words, if you're able to find out a list of email IDs on a particular computer, that means they are a valid users on their computer. Now, how could you identify such usernames? Very simple. There is one of the loopholes in your SMTP service, right? So when your SMTP service is allowing a command called verify, we could try to do email enumeration, username enumeration. So that can be possible. Very simple. When you do a -a scan, so we've already seen in the basic sessions of hacking. So there's also a playlist in our channel, my name, Basic Hacking Tutorials. So if you see there are lots of basic tutorials for regarding nmap, forward scanning, vulnerability scanning, and all the basic concepts. There you can find how do you, what are the nmap commands and what is nmap, how they use it. Right? When you do a aggressive scan in nmap, that's -a version of nmap, you get this actual result. And in that particular result, you can see there are what are the available commands with your SMTP service. So unfortunately, in our victim machine's SMTP service, they have enabled a command called as verify. Now, what is the use of verify? Let me put this in other words. So let's say when you send a mail to a person, what generally happens? The mail receives to him, isn't it? But in case if you have any typos in the mail, so in case instead of typing nbharatkumar@gmail.com, if I type nbharatkumar or nbharatkumar@gmail.com, what happens? This is obviously a typo. It's an invalid email ID. It means the user in that particular email ID does not exist. So what happens is whenever someone sends you a mail, obviously your system does a small validation saying that is nbharatkumara a valid user in gmail.com. This is the common query that your system does, or your my system or my other computer while sending a mail. This is what it will do first. It will check whether the valid username exists in your server or not. Okay, because if I send a very large attachment to my email ID, which is not existing, obviously that would be a burden for a server, isn't it? That's the reason what it will do is it will first validate whether the username exists and whether the email ID exists or not. If the user is valid, it will say yes, and thereby we can identify the user exists. If the username is invalid, we can conclude that there is no username by this name. Now, this is very good job for a mail server because it is having an efficient way to maintain your load. It can remove out the unnecessary or spam things. It can prevent from being flooded. This is a good part for your mail server. But for a hacker, it's a really juicy information. Because why? Because of this query, I can identify what all the usernames are existing in your system, isn't it? So by using this method, by making this query, I can identify what all the valid users in a system. As simple as that. Now, what is the command to support this? We as human can read this text as a text, isn't it? We as humans can easily say, is there a valid user by this name? And you can say a response, yes. But computers do not talk on that particular language, isn't it? They talk on commands and queries, right? Now, the command which will validate whether the given username exists in your mail server or not is called as verify. Okay, in case if verify command is enabled in any SMTP service, you can go forward and try and validate to check out what all usernames are existing in a system or not. Okay, so which means in simple words, since our victim machine has SMTP service running, first of all, second thing, in the SMTP service, he has enabled verify method. So hence we can go forward and we can list out what all the valid usernames are available on this particular machine. So this way we can easily identify what all the valid usernames available in the victim, available in our victim server. Okay, as simple as that. So let's go forward and let's see how this can be implemented. So we'll take the help of a tool called as SMTP user enum. So currently I'm using Parrotsec OS. So you can, in Parrotsec OS, SMTP user enum is already there. In Kali, if you're referring Kali, which I recommend to guys, this tool is not available in Kali Linux. So hence you can use a GitHub script for the same. So you can go forward to this particular URL and download the GitHub script and execute it. As simple as that. Okay, you can download it from here. I'll just pass on the URL. I'll mention it on the. Okay, we'll come under possible usernames format. Okay, you can download this script and you can implement this particular script in your attack. As simple as that. Okay. So I'll just show the same commands over here. It's the same command, except thing is you're running locally in GitHub, and in terms of command, in terms of Parrot, it's already there. The command goes like this: smtp user nm -, so just hit enter, you get the formats. The syntax is very simple. The tool name, and obviously we are going to be using the verify command to check if there's a valid user or not. And then we're going to be passing a word list, which contains a list of possible usernames, and we send it to your target machine. So this will validate in the given usernames, which all usernames does exist and which do not. So obviously you'll be requiring a word list for this. Okay. So in my case, I already have a word list, unixusers.ext, which is located inside your /user/share/word-list. Metasploit and Unix open users. Okay, it is located from that particular path. It's common for both Parrot and Kali. Right, so since we have, I have a list of valid things, so let us go forward and exploit this. Command is very simple. 20, the target machine IP address. 101. Let me save this thing into a text file, valid users through typo through smtp.txt. Done, it's almost done, wait for a while, in a couple of seconds should be done. So it's done. Let me just cat out how many valid users I have found. I think I have found 30 users. That's pretty good, isn't it? So I found 30 users. So these are the valid users in my system. So now I can go, so since I have a valid users now, I can go forward and do SSH hack. That is, I can, since I have valid users, I can download any major word list from internet, and I can try that across the SSH, and I can try to crack SSH passwords. That's a valid thing, right? But since I have already covered the password cracking, network process cracking in the previous videos, so I can have a look how to crack those passwords. But here we are only stopping this in terms of user enumeration. So this process of identifying valid usernames in a system is called as username enumeration. As simple as that. So hope you got about, it's pretty much clear about how do you identify usernames from a SMTP server if verify command is enabled. Apart from this, you cannot hack SMTP, you cannot use SMTP to hack into systems, because this does not yet have any major remote code execution kind of vulnerability in it. Right? So hence, let's skip to another next service, which is port number 53, and which is running on ISC bind 9.4.2. So let us see if this, if this has any vulnerability. So let me directly go to I googled and typed exploit. So yep, it has few issues. You can see that from Rapid7, and there are links in from Rapid7 and bind. But these issues which is shown here are used for DOS or denial of service, or also do DNS poisoning. So basically DNS is a service which is used to specify your domain name from IP address. So but it is used for poisoning. So there's a vulnerability to poison your DNS, but there's no such vulnerability for compromising and gaining access on the victim machine, right? So hence, let's skip this port. Let's go for the next port. That is port 80. So obviously it's running HTTP, which means the victim machine has a web server. Okay, in simple words, I can access this machine through my browser, as simple as that. Now, as I said in the previous session, Metasploitable is a vulnerable machine. It's a deliberately vulnerable machine so that people can practice their hacking skills on it. So hence, keeping that in mind, they have hosted vulnerable applications on this, like DBWA, Mutiny Day, or hosted on Metasploitable. But since our current context is to gain access to the victim machine, so hence we'll leave out the web application hacking out of context currently. We'll obviously we'll shortly be starting up another series for bug bounty and web application hacking. That will be out in a few days. Okay, we'll be starting that in a few days. So, but here we are. Our intention is to compromise our machine through network vulnerabilities. So, hence we will skip port 80 as well. Right. So, let's go for the next port. The next port is 111, which is running RPC. Now, RPC or your 111 port number is itself, or it is independently not such vulnerable or exploitable in a simple words. So we need another port for this. So in the next videos or in upcoming videos, I'll explain you what are those dependencies, and I'll show you how to do enumeration from that particular port and how do you exploit it in upcoming sessions. But as of now, we'll just leave it as it is. We'll skip the port 111 because it's not independently exploitable. Okay, so let's skip 111 as well and go for the next port called as 139. So 139 in Linux machines, it is used to run. It is actually hosting SMB or Samba service in it. Okay, port 111 is running Samba service. So you can see they're slightly giving you an idea of what version of Samba it is, but not giving the exact version. But if you observe, the exact version of Samba is available on port 445. So remember, in Linux, both 139 and 445 do run Samba service in it, but the exact version of Samba is identified by the port number 552. But the actual port which is running Samba as a service is port 139. So this sometimes happens, so no problem with that. But we can easily identify that my victim machine is running Samba 3.0.20 Debian version of Samba in it. So obviously it's an information disclosure. Let's go forward and find if there's any vulnerabilities in this or not. A simple same keyword was service name space exploit, and if you observe, the obviously there are a couple of vulnerabilities, and we have got the response from Rapid7 and ExploitDB in the first case. So let us have a look in. Okay, so it's loading. Let's leave it. So since I'm using a, so there are no cache. So there is a response in CV codes. Good. There are CV code. There are exploit path. The vulnerability version. You can see it is stating that Samba version 3.0.20 until 3.0.25 RC3 is vulnerable with user mem script configuration option. By using this, there's no without authentication, you can exploit this vulnerability. Okay, simple as that. So which means we'll be able to exploit this vulnerability, and it's actually a vulnerability through which we can exploit. Simple. And if you just we have got the path as well. And we have got a vulnerability code here as well. If we just see, just as a reference, if you want to see the next path, even the next result that you see from the expert database is also the same vulnerability. Speaking about user map script itself. So yes, you can test the same thing. So which means that this service can be exploitable with Metasploit. Okay, so now without wasting much time, let us dive into Metasploit and see how do you exploit this vulnerability. So let me open up my MSF console. It will take a couple of seconds. And so after that, let us import this script and go forward and exploit it. Right? So we'll wait for a while. It should take only a few seconds. Giving us access to Metasploit. So it's starting. And in a while, it should be up and running. Mm-hmm. Yep, it's done. Now let's use the script. So you can also do search with the CV code that we have currently. So 2007, and so you can say whatever it over here. 2007, 2447. You can get the path, or else you can just copy paste the same path. Both will work fine. So I'm a pretty lazy guy, so I just import it. And if you observe, the latest Linux and the latest Metasploit is onboarding the payload as well along with the exploit. So it's automatically picking up the default exploit, the default payload for the exploit, and filling up the information as well. So obviously you can try to specify your own payload as well, or else you can use a default payload as well. Right? The only option it is requiring for us to do is specify the rhost, which is nothing but the target's IP address, as simple as that. So let us start that. My target IP address is 180.0.101, and by specifying that, it's pretty much clear about all the options. So if you see here, I've successfully imported the script, I've specified the required options, and due to the latest Metasploit, I've also imported the default payload, and it's a reverse netcat. You do not get any metaparameter for this, it's a generic Unix thing. So let's try and exploit it. Should, in a while, you should be able to get the success, and here you are. Right? So if you observe, we do not, it says command shell session 1 open, but you do not see any response here. That is because we are getting a Unix terminal in the machine, which means obviously we have got an access. We can confirm that with the help of UMI and ID, even ifconfig. By 3, we can validate that we have got a root access on the victim machine whose IP address is 0.101, whose host name is Metasploitable as well. As simple as that, isn't it? So, but it does not give me any unbox. So, even though it does not give you any echo thing, like any terminal kind of thing, but we can easily confirm because it's a command shell, there is no any response for that. Okay? But from this, we can easily identify that we have gained access through Samba, username, user map, script vulnerability, and yep, it's a configuration mistake, and yes, now we have good access. To confirm that we are a root, and for the final fly, we can just echo the shadow file, through which we can prove that we have got administrative access. Perfect, right? So by this way, we can easily conclude that we have got a complete access on a victim machine. Perfect, isn't it? So let me recall what we did today. So this was our intensive force attack to gain machine through some vulnerability. So let me take a small recall. So we started with, we've already done hack victim machine through VSFTPD service in yesterday's session, in the last session. So hence we skip port 21, we go for the next ports. Port 22 does not have any remote code execution vulnerability or any kind of a command execution vulnerability. So we skip 22. 23 is also same as 22. So hence we skip 23 as well. 25 did not have any remote code execution vulnerability, but it does had verify method enable, through which we were able to identify valid usernames in the victim machines. So next, going forward, we identified that 53 is enabled, through which this machine does not have any remote code execution kind of vulnerability, but it did had DNS cache poisoning, which is obviously not required for any kind of an exploitation, for any process of identifying or gaining access on the victim machine. So hence, we skipped 53. Going forward, port 80 was enabled, that is, this was web service enabled on this machine. So web service, there's a different set of attack vectors for web applications that we'll be seeing up in upcoming series. So hence, I skipped up port 80. Going forward, 111 is independently not vulnerable, or RPC is independently not vulnerable. It requires other ports to open. So, giving that future, so I just skipped 111, and we went to 139. So, 139 was running SMB or Samba service, and 445 leaked the exact version of Samba. So that when just by typical Google out, we found out that it was vulnerable with username map script, and we utilized the vulnerability and exploited it and gain access. We still have a couple of ports opened up, like there's a lot of ports open yet, so let us use that for upcoming sessions. Obviously, in the upcoming videos, I'll explain you about other ports. I'll later explain you about what are the enumeration techniques for those ports, how do you enumerate it, and how do you use that information for your upcoming things. Okay, so this was our intention to identify or to exploit these things. I would give a small assignment for you guys. Let's see how many people can get this thing through. So so far, I used to explain you this attack and vulnerability and leave it out. But for this session, I just wanted to have a small interactive thing. So I would ask you guys to try out this. Obviously, if you try out this, try out the overall video part. And obviously, from SMTP, we have seen how to find out valid usernames, right? If you recall, we found around like 30 usernames. Now, the assignment here is, I would ask, I would recommend you to compare the username that we identified from SMTP service and the username which is actually there in the mission. So obviously with the help of Samba, we can gain access, isn't it? So I would recommend you to compare both and identify the usernames that was not identified by SMTP service and the reason why it was not identified by SMTP service. As simple as that. Clear? So the assignment is nothing but perform SMTP based service based user enumeration, perform exploitation through a Samba service, post that, compare the usernames that we cracked via SMTP service and identify the service, get the list of usernames that is through shadow file or password file, and combine both the things and give me the list of the password or the username that was not identified by the SMTP service and give me the reason why it was not identified by the SMTP service. Clear? So hope it's pretty much clear. So hope all the query things was pretty much clear. So in case, I would recommend you guys to punch it out in the comment section or in the description you also find our WhatsApp groups. You can also mention there as well regarding your solutions. Okay guys, I hope the overall video was pretty good, informative, and I hope it made sense for everyone. And I would recommend you guys to try this and also try the assignment part. So in case if you have any queries, please mention the queries in the chat box, and in the description you also have our WhatsApp group link and my Telegram group link as well. So you can punch there your queries. We should be able to answer our queries over there. So this is for today's video guys. See you all in the next video. And obviously I'll provide you the hint and the solution for the assignment that I've given today. In the next video, obviously. So this is what our plan for this today video. See you all guys in the next video. So happy hacking, everyone guys. See you all in the next video. Happy hacking guys. So what happens in SMTP service or what happens in your mail exchange service is that they differ.